population of Uganda is estimated at 46 million people. And as a result, the country is facing a shortage in the housing units. The Uganda Bureau of Statistics states that the deficit is at 2.4 million units, whereby the 210,000 units are in urban areas, but the 1.3 million units in rural areas. And it's also reported that about 900,000 units are substandard and therefore require replacement or upgrading. Today, in the Homes and Construction Affairs Show, we are going to look at condominium houses as a way to solve the problem of the housing deficit in the country. My name is Hilda Kamkama, and join me as we start the show. With a brief description, we need to understand what a condominium house is.
Okay. Well, Hilda, a condominium is basically a system of separate ownerships of individual units on a multi-building structure. So when I say multi-building structure, here we are looking at, let's say, an apartment block. So on that apartment block, you have separate apartment units. Now, we need how it comes to be called a condominium is if there is actually ownership for those different apartment units. And with ownership, it means you actually have a title of ownership that shows that you actually do own that home or that apartment.
In your own understanding, now I have told you that Uganda apparently is facing a housing deficit.
Okay.
Especially here in the urban areas.
Sure.
Do you think that condominium houses come in as a solution to the problem that we are facing as a country now?
Yes, totally. I really do think so, because there is too much of, you know, housing deficit in Kampala. First of all, Kampala itself, So if you look at condominium apartments on the market today, first of all, they are more affordable as compared to the bungalow structures. So where you'd find a condominium apartment, let's say a three-bedroom apartment being sold at 250 million in a Kampala suburb, like let's say Kira, you find a bungalow, three-bedroom bungalow being sold at even 400 million or above, which very few Ugandans can actually afford. So 250, yes, we shall not say that it's still very affordable, okay? But at least it's more affordable compared to 400 million. So the number of people that can afford 250 million are more compared to those that can afford 400 million. So yes, they are more affordable. And also with this housing deficit that is coming up, most condominium apartments are giving, the developers are giving the different owners payment plans. So you actually start paying at your own pace, slowly by slowly, in bits according to what you can afford. The mortgages from banks are also more available today. So literally, they are more affordable. They're making housing and home ownership much easier for everyone in Uganda, which would definitely solve the housing deficit.
So who is eligible to have a condominium house?
Well, everyone, you, me, everyone out there that is watching us is eligible to get a condominium apartment. All you need to do is to check out your finances, okay? So when you check out your finances and you see how much are they selling this condominium apartment at, can I afford it? What payment plan are they giving me? Is it viable for me? How am I going to be able to pay for this apartment? Am I going to use my own cash flows? Am I going to use a mortgage? Once you have finally done a very good self-financial analysis, then you know if this condominium apartment is what is for you or not. So literally, all you have to do is to just do a good financial self-analysis and then you're good to go.
With a financial analysis, here I will come with a question of affordability. Because we see people coming together, they are living in the same organized area.
Yes.
tentatively, let us talk about the cost.
Mm.
How much does one really need to part with to own
mm.
a condominium? Let me say, mm. okay, two bedrooms.
Now, if for the two bedroom apartment, like let's say for this project that we are at the moment, Bella Rosa Homes, mm. a two bedroom apartment here costs 200 million Uganda shillings. So just like I said, with a good financial self-analysis, you have to you look at the payment plan that you're giving. If you bought it at this stage when it's ready for construction, definitely the payment plan would be shorter.
Mm.
So if you're giving it like, let's say 5 months to pay up, so you have to check your finances. Do you have all that amount of money in your bank account?
Mm-hmm.
Or would you need to go and get a mortgage from the bank in order to support this, paying up for this property? Or do you have, let's say, a property that you want to sell off and then get those finances and invest in this condominium
mm.
apartment? So basically, you have to look at the payment plan that we're giving you. Then, if you found Bella Rosa Homes years back when you were still constructing, you would have been so lucky to pay with a payment plan that is long enough for even as long as 24 months. Because we usually give our clients a 24-month payment plan.
When you are starting construction.
Yes, when you're starting construction. So you're basically moving the whole
24
journey.
24 months, those are 2 years.
Yes, 2 years.
So with a 200 million, 24 months, that means I'm depositing how much every month?
Well, now that depends on still you as a person. Still, it goes back to your self-financial analysis. We are very friendly people. We like to sit down with our clients and come up with a payment plan that is friendly for you and friendly for us as well, so that we'd have, you know, a good business and a good relationship.
Mm.
So basically what we do is we sit down with you and say, how much can you afford monthly? Are you going to be making, amounts of money that are the same each and every month,
or are you going to get a lump sum, like 15 million at a go?
Exactly. Are you going to do that? Are you going to be on a reducing balance type of payment plan? So it basically comes back to you how much you can afford in monthly in those 24 months, as long as you keep your payment plan active. Yes.
Now, what happens after that 24 months elapse when your client has not cleared to zero balance?
Okay. So like I told you earlier, Hilda, we like to make a relationship with our clients.
True.
Yes. So what the 24 months have elapsed, you still have a balance. We can continue. We ask you, how much more time do you need to pay for this apartment? If you tell us, let's say, give me 6 more months. Then we definitely do allow and we make it easier for you. If you think, let's say, you don't have enough money, then we can advise you to get, let's say, a mortgage from the bank, because you have an MOU that we signed with most of these
banks around.
Yes, that are around. So they would support you if you are fit to get a mortgage.
Mm.
Yeah. So usually we advise our clients, if you think you may need to get a mortgage right from the beginning, before you even start the whole process, go to the bank and find out if the bank can actually, if you qualify for a mortgage. Yeah, or not. If you feel like, if you find out that you can't qualify and you don't think you'll be able to finish, you know, the amount of money that you're asking you to pay for that apartment is more, then we definitely ask you maybe to get something cheaper or maybe to wait for some time so that it doesn't stress you and we also don't have to come running after you. Yes.
So with the condominiums, because we really need to understand.
Yes.
What are the benefits really of condominiums over the normal houses that you've been having, owning, like constructing at your own pace? What are the advantages?
I'll talk about the benefits of living in a condominium society before I talk about the benefits of buying it when it's ready, besides construction. So some of the benefits of living in a condominium society is that security. Yeah. So you find so many people feel more secure to live in a condominium society.
Mm.
Why? Because usually most of the condominium societies have, before you enter, they're gated communities. And before you enter that gate, there is a security guard. So before someone even enters the society, the security guard will ask you to sign, where are you going?
Mm.
Okay? So literally, it's so hard for a thief to, you know, come, steal whatever they're stealing and then run out. Exactly. So security is a very big issue for condominium societies. Another thing that is very advantageous about living in a condominium society is that you're living in a community. Okay, so living in a community is that you get to relate with people more, your neighbors, you're living with people that are same like-minded, okay? So if you want to do something that is going to help all of you, definitely it's easy for you to have a discussion with your neighbors, and then you're able to do, you know, most of these things, yeah, together.
It's something that yeah. is going to help or benefit everyone.
Yeah.
What do you mean in this case?
In this case, like, let's say insurance, insuring, you don't have to insure the whole block by yourself. Here, you're bringing money together, let's say, to insure your whole block. If you want to, let's say, add something that is going to help all of you in the society, like, let's say, in the amenities, in the amenities that you're being offered in that society, like a swimming pool or like the kids play area, you want to change something for the benefit of all of you, it's so easy for you to come together, talk together,
discuss.
And then you're basically able to discuss with the older people. You realize people today, the older you get, you're getting more lonely, okay? Some people don't even visit their parents back in the villages. So here you're literally living in a community where you're seeing people, and even as we get older, Hilda, today so many people have constructed houses, a 6-bedroom house. And then your kids outgrow, they grow, they move out wherever
and
they are going.
All alone.
And you're all alone in a 6-bedroom house whereby even your grandchildren only visit you over the holidays.
True that.
Yeah, so we have so many older people, older couples that have come and they're living in a 2-bedroom house that is more manageable for them. It's closer to very many facilities like hospitals. Usually these condominium apartments are constructed in places that are closer to, you know, different facilities, like malls, hospitals. The road is not very far away. So they are, in terms of convenience, they are a very perfect option. Then if I can talk about buying a condominium apartment as a site's construction, so many people today, especially like people in the diaspora, their money has been stolen. Why?
Yeah.
Because I called Susan, my sister, and I told her, construct for me, I'm sending you money to construct for me, you know, my house. And then Susan eats the money, okay?
Because so, the other one is your relative.
Your relative, and you're not really around to supervise, okay? So it's safer to buy an apartment that is ready, okay? Not even just a house. If you want a bungalow still, it's safer for you to buy from a company that is trusted, okay? Because you know you're sending to someone, a trusted entity. So basically, it's safer to buy a ready property. Even with, if you're, today very, very many people have busy schedules whereby you don't even have time to, you know, go and supervise the works that are going on for construction. So it's usually better for you to buy something that is ready, and then you're literally able to come back anytime, stay in your house. You don't have to go and stay at a hotel, pay a lot of money for just one night or a week that you're going to spend in Kampala. So you literally have your house right here.
Now, I come back to the developers. We have trust issues, you know.
Yes.
I'll come, get a developer, get into an agreement that I'll take perhaps a 3-bedroomed condo.
Yes.
But then the mixture of materials for construction also is a problem, because we are told that some people compromise.
Yeah.
And along the way, the client is the one that is going to suffer the loss of repairs.
Yes, that's
now,
true.
Now, how do you handle that?
We start selling right from the word go. So before this structure even comes up, we are still at the level, you know, the ground level. We start selling off these apartments. Why we do this is because we want to take the client with us during the journey of construction. So immediately you come on board and you book an apartment unit at that stage, you are very welcome to the site to come and, you know,
supervise
as well. If you have time, you can pass by. We keep sending our clients construction updates. We encourage them to actually keep going to these sites while construction is going on. That way you're able to see the types of materials we are using.
The owner is given a title.
Yes.
What type of title is given to the clients?
Okay. Yeah, but maybe just for advice for anyone out there, if you're buying a condominium apartment, make sure to see what type of title it is. It could be maybe a condominium title that is under a lease. because maybe the land was under lease. So literally you have to check out and see what type of condominium title it is.
Susan, hold on that very bit. Mm. We need you to now clarify for everyone out there which land titles should be looked out for, especially when one is planning to have a condominium.
Well, I think it doesn't really matter because if it is a Milo, yes, you own it forever. You own it in perpetuity. You can resell. Your children will inherit. You can rent it out. Literally, it's your
property.
Your property. Even with a lease, it depends on the period that lease is going for. Okay, so you have to check out for how long is this lease. Okay, you have to look out the number of years that lease is going to be running for. Okay, so if you still, it will go back to the argument that you have with the seller. If the seller told you you're going to own this apartment for this period of time, then you're good to go. But if they tell you maybe it's a Milo and then you get to find, oh, it's only a lease, then you have a reason to, you know, open your mind, open your eyes and ask them, why is it like this and all. But it doesn't matter as long as you have come to good terms with a seller and the seller has explained to you, you know the terms that are in your sales agreement.
Now, for different sites and different projects, at what point does a developer like get their hands off, like stop evolving in the day-to-day activities of a facility or
of
a project?
Of a project after construction. Now, when we are done with construction totally, we stay in management for like about 3 months, depending on the project. Different projects have different periods, but let's say like 3 months. So during those 3 months, remember we sold to different people
too,
so they do not know each other. So during those 3 months, we are basically helping you get to know each other. So we create, like, let's say a group where you're all in that group. We help you form a condominium association. We literally bring you we literally are helping you get to understand the whole condominium setting, because some people are new to this. They buy without knowing how it works. And also during those 3 months, we're basically helping you get in the know of how the whole condominium setting actually works. So after the 3 months, then we hand over to you, the owners. So you as the owners now can take on from us and bring in your own property manager or manage yourselves, depending on how you people will feel suits.
Because I'm looking at now security for starters. After the 3 months, it means the owners of a facility or the owners of the condominiums of a given project take on. They choose which security to use, or
yes, they will choose. We do not dictate. Once the developer is done, we are done. So it's up to you, the owners. You form a condominium association that will help you govern each other. So that condominium society has to ensure, you know, comfortable living of each and every member of that society. Okay, and also to help manage each and everything. So that condominium association is made up of you people, the owners. So it will be upon you to elect the president for that condominium association, to elect all the different board members. So according to what the board is going to decide, you people will go with that. But we shall not influence it. All we can do is advise, in case you need our advice.
In an event where we have tear and wear issues, for instance, maybe like the plumbing issues, or maybe the tiles are just popping out, or maybe the bubbling of walls, how does a condominium owner helped okay from a developer by a developer.
Okay, well, if in case something like that comes up and it's our fault that it is happening, definitely we have to come and fix it. But if it has happened because of you, the owner, definitely that would be on you. You'd have to fix it.
What do you mean by if it happens? Or what falls under the category of when the owner is the one that
mishandled? Well, what falls in that category is if it is, let's say, a construction fault or paint fault. Let's say if it falls in our fault, if we did maybe something went wrong during the construction, that falls under the category of what we have to fix.
Could you mind mentioning what could possibly go wrong when the construction is ongoing and then the effect is seen by a tenant while the
So let's say it's a plumbing issue.
Okay.
Let's say plumbing issue, which is our fault, because sometimes some owners also they you know flush things that are going to block the pipes. So that would be on the owner. If we now, how for us we are able to manage that is that most of our properties have, you know, a duct. So in that duct we put the pipes outside the block so that we don't have to come and start banging. So the pipes are all outside, so we literally just have to go and open and then fix it and unblock it. Yeah, but then that would still be because the owner, the person staying in the occupant, basically is the one that has done that. But then if it is our fault, maybe during the construction something went wrong, then we definitely have to come and fix it. If it is an electrical issue, maybe some of the bulbs, some of the lights are flickering, maybe because of the connection and all, we have to come and fix it with our electrician. If let's say the paint, maybe there is dampness somewhere, sometimes dampness is caused because of different issues that engineers know better, okay? So because of those issues, we definitely have to come with our engineer and we fix it, okay? So basically that's how we would deal with such issues.
So with the condominium setups, is family limited?
Well, with condominium setups, it's basically comes down to you who is buying. What is your need for buying it? Are you buying it for your family to stay in? Are you buying it for rental purposes? So if you say you're buying it for your family, I would ask you, Hilda, how big is your family? If your family, let's say your family is made up of six people, you and your husband and then your four children,
and then my help,
and then your helper, so you're seven people in your family, a two-bedroom apartment would be small for your whole family to live comfortably.
True that.
Yeah, so you have to look at an apartment that has more number of bedrooms, like let's say a four-bedroom house would be good for you and your family. So definitely it comes back to you looking at how many bedrooms are going to be able to be enough for me and my family. If you're buying it for rent, for rental purposes, then that means you have to look at the smallest number of bedrooms, because on the market most of the number of bedrooms that are selling out there are a two-bedroom apartment or let's say one-bedroom apartment. So you basically can go ahead and buy a two-bedroom apartment and make sure that even your tenant that is coming, you let them know that if your family is bigger than this number, then maybe no, because there would be the pressure on the house would be quite a lot. Flushing, the number of people, if you're three people and you're flushing, it's lesser compared to seven people flushing. Yeah.
Now on that very note, because I've heard you continuously say apartment, apartment.
Yes.
What is the difference between an apartment and a condominium?
Okay. Now, Hilda, when I say apartment and then when I say condominium, yes, people usually confuse that, okay?
That's why I need us to clear it up.
To clear it up, yeah. So with a condominium, it comes with a word that is ownership. Okay, and then with an apartment, it comes with there is no ownership with an apartment. So with a condominium, first of all, let's say that apartment unit that you live in, you basically have to have a title of ownership to that apartment unit.
That is when it becomes a condominium.
A condominium, yes. So you basically have a title of ownership for that apartment unit, which means you literally can resell that apartment. You can go get a mortgage on that apartment. You can rent it out. You can resell that very apartment. Your children will inherit it. But then if you just go and live in an apartment, it means you're maybe living there as a tenant, okay? So you don't own it. You have to pay the owner of that apartment rental fees. Yeah, so that means you're basically living there as a tenant. So with an apartment unit, unless you're the owner of the whole block, you literally live in that apartment unit as a tenant. And then with a condo, you're living there as an owner, or you're renting it out because you are the owner of that apartment unit. Yes.
Now for the condos, what are the do's and don'ts that you always share with your clients from inception?
Okay. Now, with the condos, basically, it all comes back to the society, the condominium association. Now, this condominium association usually comes up with some rules and regulations that are supposed to be followed by all the members. Otherwise, it would be chaos, okay? So with those rules and regulations, they would help you know, what are we supposed to do in this society? What aren't we supposed to do in this society? Now, like in one of our, most of our projects, actually, we put the clothing wires on the rooftop. So in the rules, you will see that no occupant is allowed to hang clothing clothes on the balcony. You have to take them to the rooftop. Yeah, so those are the different rules that govern this different condominium association.
Forget about the hectic processes that you go through to acquire a home. Have you thought of what you go through to get the land titles correct, the physical planning approved, getting the right engineers, the right designs? You can have all that solved by having a condominium house. You just pay at once. Remember, here you choose even where you want to be the location, and you're going to have nice neighborhood with great amenities. Thank you for watching the Homes and Construction Show. My name is Hilda Kamkama, and from me and my entire crew, we say bye-bye.